Today we're going to cover some of the events that occur during the third week of development. The most important event that takes place during this week is gastrulation. In fact, distinguished developmental biologist Lewis Wolpert once said, "It's not birth, marriage, or death, but gastrulation which is truly the most important time in your life." Let's see why he thought so. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the Histology Wizard. So what exactly is gastrulation? Well, we know that the process of gastrulation takes that bilaminar embryo from week 2, which contains the trophoblast and the embryoblast, and turns it into a trilaminar or three-layer embryo, still a flat disk. Gastrulation also starts the process of morphogenesis, that process where individual cells undergo complex movements that will generate tissues and organs. So what's really the big picture here? What are the actual end results of gastrulation? Well, gastrulation establishes the three germ layers from which all tissues, organs, and cells in the body arise: the ectoderm, the mesoderm, and the endoderm. Now, because the actual mechanics of gastrulation, by the end of week 3, this process is pretty complete for the head region, but the process continues to occur for the rest of the embryo. And so our embryo really is developing in a cephalic or cranial to caudal manner. You can think about this as head to tail or head to toe. In addition, after gastrulation, we can really see the establishment of all the body axes. Now, even though some of these specifications, such as establishment of the cranial caudal axis, begin even earlier at blastocyst stages, by the end of week 3, we really see that trilaminar embryo where cells are now positioned to take on specific fates over the next several weeks. Essentially, the stage is now set for organogenesis. So let's walk through the actual process, at least as best we can when looking at 2D images. Gastrulation begins with the formation of the primitive streak on the epiblast surface, shown here by this oval-shaped disc. So first, let's get oriented. We'll mark the cranial or cephalic end of the embryo. This is the site of the future oropharyngeal membrane and the site of the future mouth. And the future cloacal membrane is going to mark that caudal end of the embryo. And these two areas are interesting because they consist of tightly adhering ectoderm and endoderm, and they will never have mesoderm in the middle. Now, the primitive streak starts at the caudal end of the embryo and lengthens via proliferation of epiblast cells. And it's visible if you look down on an embryo as a narrow groove that kind of bulges on either side. The cranial end of the streak is called the primitive node, and it is a slightly elevated area that surrounds a depression called the primitive pit. And the primitive node is critical for establishing things like the left-right axis of the embryo and involves a gene appropriately called nodal. And nodal is also critical for upregulating genes involved in formation of mesoderm subtypes. Now, the primitive streak is what we actually see on the embryo, and this indicates cells are moving into the embryo to form additional germ layers. And the primitive pit and the groove are where the epiblast cells are going to leave the primitive streak and move into the interior of the embryo to become the definitive endoderm and the mesoderm. And so here we actually have a chick video from Dr. Gary Schoenwolf that shows the process of primitive streak formation and shows the beginning of gastrulation. So you could see those cells moving in, so let's look a little more closely at those cell movements. Here's a cross-section of the embryo again, with the blue epiblast cells and the yellow hypoblast cells. And you can see that brown primitive streak as well. So the epiblast cells are going to proliferate, and they're going to move towards the primitive streak, and they're actually going to change shape so that they look almost bottle-shaped. And this is called epithelial to mesenchymal transition. Then they're going to detach from the epiblast and slip beneath it. And this important process is called ingression. Now, the first cells that move interiorly will displace the hypoblast cells, and they're going to form the definitive endoderm. Other cells are going to halt their migration between the endoderm and the epiblast to become mesoderm. And once you have mesoderm and definitive endoderm, the remaining epiblast cells will become ectoderm. So back to our big picture. Let's review what becomes of that bilaminar disc after Let's review what becomes of our bilaminar disc after gastrulation. So the epiblast is going to form the ectoderm, the endoderm, and the mesoderm. And the midline portion of the ectoderm will go on to form the neuroectoderm, that is the nervous system, and the rest will become epidermis. Endoderm will form the gut tube and the digestive system as well as the lungs, while the mesoderm will be divided into zones, which we'll talk about in a couple of minutes. And it's going to form muscle, bone, cartilage, the kidneys, blood, and much, much more. And the hypoblast is now going to form the extraembryonic endoderm and eventually the yolk sac endoderm. So with the formation of the primitive streak in gastrulation, we can now begin to appreciate all of the major body axes. So here's our epiblast again with the primitive streak on the top surface, and I've chopped through the embryo so you can see the different layers, the epiblast and the hypoblast, as well as some of those movements that are going to form the definitive endoderm and the definitive mesoderm. Now let's look at this embryo and see what will become the adult axes. First, we have that dorsal ventral axis. So in the adult, you can think back to belly, or roughly here, ectoderm versus endoderm. We have that left-right axis that's first established by nodal signaling, the cranial cephalic caudal axis, or head-to-tail or head-to-toe axis, and also that medial lateral axis with the primitive streak marking the medial aspect of the embryo. Now I want to take a step back and think about what's going on at the molecular level. During this third week of development, these events that we're talking about today are tightly regulated by networks of genes, and they produce proteins important for signaling. Mutations in these genes or alterations in these signals can lead to congenital abnormalities. And this week is also a very sensitive time for teratogenic insults, and I'll highlight a few of these as we go on. Researchers have made fate maps using tracers, and they've made them for various organ systems. And so we know that the cell populations in these regions can be damaged by teratogens or mutations, and that can affect the signaling molecules which are normally expressed in those regions. Now I want to quickly look at one example of an important signaling process, the establishment of the left-right axis. Now I want to make it clear, we don't know all the players yet in this process, and we don't completely understand how this process works in humans, but we'll consider this a working model, one that's supported by a lot of data from animal model systems and from mutations and diseases in humans. So here we have our embryo with the primitive streak and the primitive node. Now we know that the node secretes a number of critical signaling molecules, and one of these I'm just going to call the morphogen because it isn't exactly clear what this signal is. Now we also have cells within the node that are ciliated, and those cilia are motile, and the movement of those cilia is going to sweep fluid to the left of the embryo. And among other things, this causes a concentration on the left side and an upregulation of the nodal protein. Now this protein is then going to induce a signaling cascade that involves upregulation of the gene PITX2, that involves upregulation of the gene PITX2. And PITX2 is actually known as a master gene in left-right asymmetry. PITX2 is going to activate its own signaling cascade, and that results in the directing of organ placement. So for example, this gene network controls things such as heart looping, and as a result, the heart is going to lie to the left within the thoracic cavity. And mutations involved in any of these steps, mutations in cilia, in nodal, PITX2, other genes, can cause what we call laterality defects, some of which are asymptomatic and others which can result in multiple clinical problems. So let's take an example of Cartagener syndrome. This is one of the primary ciliary dyskinesias. In this syndrome, there's a mutation in the motor protein dynein that's located on primary cilia. And so what this means practically is that the nodal cilia can't rotate. And so they are unable to sweep and cause that left-sided flow. So left-right asymmetry is not established. And this results in something called situs inversus, in which the major visceral organs are reversed or mirrored from their normal positions. So here's an example. This is a chest x-ray of a 17-year-old girl who has Cartagener syndrome. And you can see that the heart is on the right side. This is called dextrocardia. You can also see a bubble from the stomach, which is also on her right side. And these two things are indicating the abnormal placement of her organs. Now let's move on and talk a little more about the organization of the trilaminar embryo. We know a lot about the organization of this early trilaminar embryo. So we know that regions of the epiblast have been mapped. We know where they migrated and where they ingressed through the primitive streak. We know this from animal models, and we know their ultimate fates. So we're going to start cranially, with cells that ingress through the cranial node region to form the prechordal plate and the notochord. The prechordal plate, seen here in yellow, is formed from some of the very first cells that migrate through the node that move cranially to the location between the tip of the notochord and that oral pharyngeal membrane. And cells from this region contribute to some of the head mesenchyme, and we know that it is an important organizer of the head. It's also the source of important signaling molecules, and the most important is sonic hedgehog. Now, this signaling from the prechordal plate helps establish the cranial midline, that is, of the face and the brain. Now, prechordal plate signaling is required in the prechordal plate, the forebrain, and the facial mesoectoderm. And how do we actually know this? Well, we know that reduced signaling from this area results in defective face and brain structures. And in particular, we know what happens when sonic hedgehog signaling is disrupted. Seen here are two examples of sonic hedgehog mutations that result in holoprosencephaly. So the child on the left has a milder phenotype with characteristic midline features, so eyes are set somewhat close together, and the nose is kind of has a large bridge. And the right image shows a fetus with much more severe holoprosencephaly, with fused anterior structures, a smaller brain, and cyclopia. Now we know that sonic hedgehog affects cell division in the developing midline structures. Again, we know this mostly from mice. And we also know that surgical ablation of the prechordal plate in mice can give the same result, that is a cyclopic effect. We also know that teratogens such as alcohol can kill cells in this prechordal plate region, and the result is a deficiency of midline craniofacial structures, and you've probably seen this in images of children with fetal alcohol syndrome. This can also result in holoprosencephaly. So now we've talked about that prechordal plate, so we're going to continue on and look at more patterning of the trilaminar embryo. We know that mesoderm, for example, is going to start out as that loose mat of cells that's ingressed from the epiblast, and it's going to reorganize to form major substructures. So other than the prechordal plate, the notochord is also called the chord of mesoderm, and that's considered the most cranial mesodermal structure. And next we have the cardiogenic mesoderm. So this is really interesting mesoderm. It's cranial at this stage, and you can see it in these two blue ovals. It actually has migrated cranially, so it's going to be actually cranial to the neural plate, but it's going to form cardiac mesoderm, so it's going to be involved in heart development. And it's by subsequent head folding of the embryo that it's going to be relocated to the thorax. Next, we have cells that are migrating from the cranial end of the streak that are going to form paraxial mesoderm. That's going to give rise to mesodermal head structures, and there is also paraxial mesoderm of the trunk, which is going to form somites, cartilage, dermis, and skeletal muscle. We next have intermediate mesoderm of the trunk, and that's going to form the urogenital system. And finally, we have the lateral plate mesoderm seen here in green, which is formed from cells that are going to migrate through the more caudal end of the streak. Now, I didn't show it here for simplicity's sake, but we have even more caudal cells that are going to give rise to tail bud mesoderm, and the caudalmost cells will give rise to extraembryonic mesoderm. That's going to contribute to the chorion. So here's an electron micrograph cross-section that I've just colored in to show those relative positions of the trunk mesoderm populations, along with the ectoderm and the endoderm. So we're going to look at a few of these in further detail, bearing in mind that we're going to come back to all of these populations as we talk about formations of specific body systems. So just lateral to the neural tube, we're going to see the paired paraxial mesoderm, and I've colored that in pink. And these are going to give rise to the somites, which in turn are the progenitors of the axial skeleton, the dermis, and skeletal muscle. So let's dive a little deeper into that process. So we know that the paraxial mesoderm, or the somite, is going to divide into two populations. The sclerotome, in purple, which is going to give rise to the axial skeleton, that is the vertebrae, the ribs, and the sternum, and the dermamyotome. The dermamyotome is going to further subdivide into the dermatome, which will give rise to the dermis, and the myotome, which will give rise to skeletal muscle. Just lateral to the somites, we have the intermediate mesoderm, seen here in orange or yellow-orange. And this mesoderm is going to form the urinary system and parts of the reproductive system. Even more laterally, we have that lateral plate mesoderm, which is going to give rise to the body wall, part of the limbs, and visceral covering of organs. Now, the lateral plate mesoderm is going to divide even further into two layers to form the somatic and splanchnic mesoderm. So, the dorsal layer associated with the ectoderm is called the somatic mesoderm, soma meaning body. And this mesoderm, sometimes also called parietal mesoderm, is going to give rise to the inner lining of the body wall, the dermis, and part of the limbs. In addition, the somatic mesoderm and the adjacent ectoderm are going to act together to form structures. And because they act together, they're sometimes called the somatoplure. That's shown here in the darker blue and the light blue inside the box. The ventral layer of the lateral plate mesoderm is adjacent to the endoderm, and it's called the splanchnic or visceral mesoderm. And this is going to give rise to the covering of visceral organs and part of the wall of the viscera. Again, it acts, in this case with endoderm, to form the splanchnopure. And again, the splanchnic mesoderm acts together with the endoderm to form the splanchnopure, which will give rise to some structures in the body. So that's it for the basic mesoderm divisions. Now we know that problems with mesodermal formation can occur. For example, if fewer cells fail to ingress through the primitive streak to form mesoderm, or if those mesodermal cells fail to migrate to the correct areas, we can have serious abnormalities. Caudal dysplasia, including sacral agenesis, can be induced in mouse models by mutations, but also by teratogens such as insulin. In humans, caudal dysplasia, which affects the lower limbs and vertebrae, often occurs as a result of gestational diabetes where there are elevated insulin levels. So this ends our whirlwind trip through gastrulation, the primary developmental event occurring in week 3. Now, you may not be convinced that gastrulation is the most important time in your life, but I hope you have a better sense of the importance of this developmental process in setting up the body plan. Be sure to check out, like, and comment on my other videos. Suggestions and topics always welcome. Thanks for stopping by.